Глубоко уважаемый президиум, глубоко уважаемые коллеги, данная тема стала возможна лишь по одной причине, неумолимый факт.
Esteemed Presidium, esteemed colleagues, this topic is topical, the degree of interaction and mutual understanding at our institution is such that the pathologist is a member of a multidisciplinary team. We have to define the histologically the type of lung cancer. Within the framework of a multidisciplinary team, what is the role of a pathologist? We have to define the primary pathological or morphological diagnosis, whether it is small cell or non-small cell lung cancer. But also if we look at TRUSCA guidelines, we have to clarify whether it is squamous cell cancer, adenocarcinoma, or large cell cancer. Why? Because after the morphology, the molecular genetic testing takes place, and the pathologist occupies the place at the beginning of this marathon, and hence he has to plan his own time and efforts. The classical morphology study is the comparison of a normal morphology picture of normal lung tissue and the sample. Look at the normal lung tissue, please. What is a lung tissue all about? Alveolar structures and the interalveolar septums that are a little bit thicker than the erythrocyte diameter or as a blood cell. Adenocarcinoma, you see the alveoli walls actually covered by the tumor cells. And we usually define it as adenocarcinoma of, we speak about the mutation in the GPR gene, and what if we have clinical risk factors? We may have HER2 mutations, CRAS and BRAF. But if we can use immunotherapy, we may have expression of PD-L1. What's to be done first? Shall we carry out the morphology study and use all the material, but this will mean that there will be no tumor cells for the further analysis, molecular genetic. It is so if we have a scenery subtype, it means that the tumor consists of the glands with the tumor cells. But we may have a solid subtype of adenocarcinoma. But you may see easily how easily a solid adenocarcinoma may be confused with the large cell cancer, though the diameter of the tumor cells differ. In this case, we use immunohistochemistry, and this is our area of responsibility. We are lucky because as of now the algorithms are very clear, and by performing a minimal histology panel, in 80 to 90% of cases, we can define the subtype of non-small cell lung cancer. Two biopsies. One column and three columns, different diagnostic possibilities for the surgeon. In the microscopy, you can see the tumor cells, but in immunohistochemistry, you see TGF1 expression, nuclear one, while in the second case, cytoplasmic expression of CK56. In the first case, we see the picture of adenocarcinoma, while in the second case, squamous cell carcinoma. In 10% of our observations, based on immunohistochemistry, we can detect a non-specific phenotype, and the morphology diagnosis may remain the same, non-small cell lung cancer. This may certainly lead to certain dissatisfaction in oncologists, among oncologists, and we try to minimize such cases. But then we have to define predictive factors. For example, okay, immunohistochemistry is a benchmark, and the references are molecular genetic methods. But you understand that there are many barriers here. We have to look at the depth of molecular genetic analysis and immunohistochemistry screening, which is quite simple and easier to perform compared to all the volume of tests connected with ILK, translocation, transponent expression, etc. Immunohistochemical expression of ILK together with FISH allow us to quite clearly evaluate the status of molecular damage of ILK. The second target, which we see much rarer, is ROS1. Immunohistochemistry together with FISH may be quite an efficient tool to find this rare target. Well, we remember that the reference method still remains molecular genetic tests. Immuno-oncology success led to the fact that one of the prospective immunohistochemistry markers that are being assessed by the pathologist are PD-L1 marker that are studied in the masses in the lungs. We have to take into account the criteria, the specifics of the clones, the specifics of different reactions. Which problems do we come across? True heterogeneity, low, high-grade non-small cell lung cancer, and you may see pronounced expression of PD-L1 marker in the middle, a moderate expression, and on the right, the area of tumor cells that are not stained with PD-L1 marker. Each pathomorph and morphological lab has certain staining system either by Ventana or other manufacturers. This is very good because the immunohistochemistry is totally standardized, but all the other stages of processing are still being carried out in 3-liter jars. And next area of responsibility is the study of remote macro preparation after surgery. New TNM version led to the following. First, the criteria have changed. T4 is when the tumor exceeds 7 centimeters, and thus the pathologist has a diagnostic challenge facing him to define the size of the tumor. We have to define up to in millimeters, and this prolongs the morphological study. Next diagnostic task is to assess the resection edge. The bronchial wall is a very complicated structure with submucosa, peribronchial, bronchial epithelium, bronchial gland, and lymphatic vessel, visceral pleura, peribronchial invasion is peribronchial fat, but we may have peribronchial invasion submucosal invasion epithelium and number four lymphatic infiltration that may be seen in our micro preparation, and this has to be reflected in our conclusion. Next diagnostic task. It is to assess the invasion of visceral pleura. This can be done only together with the radiologist or radial diagnostic specialist, because look at the image and the staining where we may see elastic fibers and the focus cues of adenocarcinoma may be seen. There are very few places where additional immunohistochemistry reactions are carried out, including the elastic fibers, in order to assess the invasion of visceral pleura. Vascular invasion. This demands a very thorough assessment of the whole preparation. How the vessels look like. Red blood cells are located in the center, while on the right we see the thrombus structure and the adenocarcinoma focus located in the center. The invasion of the tumor into the vessels assessment significantly prolongs the time of the test. New nosological unions in the current guidelines: adenocarcinoma in situ and minimally invasive adenocarcinoma. To set this diagnosis, we have to cooperate with the radiologist, the surgeon who performed the intervention, and the pathologist. Because we may just miss such formation when we study the preparation, micro preparation, in a standard way. Besides, half an hour ago, Yevgeny Vladimirovich mentioned that we have to assess lymph nodes in the remote preparation. If we speak about Petrov Oncocenter, lymph nodes, first to 10th groups are studied by a surgeon, 10th to 14th group are studied by a pathologist. This improves the results of the assessment, because we can increase the number of the lymph nodes we study and study the topography more thoroughly. Besides, levels 10, 11, 12, who can tell me that you have the descriptions of the 12th level in your conclusion, or even 11? Not always they are present, while 5-year survival of the patients, depending on the metastatic development, may be different, significantly different. New field of activities, but what is really new? Morphology analysis prior to molecular testing. We are at a stage when we have a problem of not defining the histological type of the tumor, but other tasks. EGFR gene in studying squamous cell cancer is not worthwhile. The patient may have fourth stage and the test is not needed. We have to define the ratio of tumor, non-tumor for the sensitivity of the test, because the GFR gene study in the sample where we have 10% of tumor cells is okay. But if we study mutations of C790N, this may be insufficient. And here, the pathologist has to cooperate with the geneticist. They have to trust each other. The pathologist states the amount of tumor cells in the sample, and this will lead to the proper interpretation of the results, because molecular genetic testing is not a black box, but means the active participation of molecular diagnostic specialists. Then we have to assess the representativeness of the sample. Number three and number four, the same. The control of the adequacy of sample processing, the quality of the preparations that go for consultancy studies and molecular genetic analysis vary greatly. In various pathomorphologies, sometimes the quality may be rather poor. So we have to improve the quality of the pathodiagnostics. We also have to assess the concomitant pathological processes that make molecular profiling difficult. The pathologist, in cooperation with the geneticist, may say that, for example, this sample has a lot of elements, non-tumor elements, that may complicate the final interpretation of the PCR product. And also we have to assess the pronouncement of the intratumor heterogeneity. The tumor may consist of several components, and this may impact the final result of molecular testing. That's it, and thank you. Thank you, Alexander. Any questions to Alexander? Questions to Alexander, please. No questions. I didn't understand. How did you distribute the sequence and stages of studying the lymph nodes? You named the lymph nodes studied by the surgeons and the ones studied by the morphologists. Why so? This is more a question to me, by the way. We are stratifying when we cut the preparation. We break down for the morphologists, the surgeons after the operation, dissect. You present this as an innovation, but this has been done for a long time. It was said by the presenter that one group are studied by the surgeons, while this is a macroscopic stage, while microscopic. Microscopic certainly are by qualified experts. You define the groups of lymph nodes. From 10 to 14. Usually we say bronchopulmonary involvement. We stratify from group 10 to group 14. Which lymph nodes are involved?